Hi everyone, my name's Beck and it's my pleasure and privilege to work at Longbeach Anglican Parish, and I would like to welcome you to our online service. And we have a special kind of service today where we're going to focus on social justice kind of things. So we've been reading from Micah, we've been reading from Amos, and today we're going to read from James, all of which encourage us to put our faith into action. So I'm going to share from James, like I just said. We're going to pray together. We're going to sing some songs together. We're going to hear from the lovely ladies from Winter Warmers. And we're going to hear from Samaritan's Purse and some other organizations that we can support. So that we can share God's love with people from all over the world. So I hope you enjoyed today's service.
Would you like to join us as we sing together the song, Blessed Be Your Name? There are so many blessings that come our way. And sometimes even in those hard times, we can see the blessings that God has given to us. So join us as we sing this together.
Be your name.
pleasure to introduce to you today Dale and Christina. So hello, ladies.
Hello.
Hello,
everybody.
Would you guys like to introduce yourselves in a little bit more detail?
Okay, hi, I'm Dale Salisbury, for those who don't know me, and I've been part of this parish for 23 years. Go, Christina.
Oh, I get to go too. I've been a part of St. Aidan's for about 38 years or something around that time, but I've also been connected with St. Chad's too, because my parents actually went to St. Chad's. So my mum and dad's ashes are actually in the memorial garden, and there's a tree that's grown like four times as big as it should have, and that was from my parents' ashes. So I reckon they were a good stock. But yes, so I've been going to both churches really for a long time.
That's awesome. And how have you guys been keeping occupied during this lockdown?
I haven't had a lot of trouble. I've been working mostly 4 days a week, so that's kept me out of trouble and kept me busy. And then I've certainly watched quite a few series and things on TV, done some study, done some gardening, natted with people in the street, got to know them well. So, yeah, I haven't really had trouble keeping busy. Walking, I'm not walking.
And it's pretty much the same here. I work 3 days a week. I've been working 3 days a week from home for most of the time. And I do a lot of things like watch TV. So at the moment I'm sewing a lot of things for Samaritan's Purse and doing lots of things like that. But I also do a bit of card making, and I've been doing a few things for messages for my grandchildren and reading like stories online through Facebook and sending them to them so they have a look at them and have a bit of a laugh when their nana does funny things. So apart from that, oh, and of course Dale and I have a little bit of fun together, don't we, Dale? We play games online. We play Ticket to Ride game online through FaceTime, and we played Bananagram too. Although because we're doing the one bubble thing, the one-to-one bubble, Dale and I have been actually saw each other this week and we had a game, didn't we, Dale? That we don't play very often, so that was kind of fun too. But we do lots of things. We keep busy.
Fair enough. So we're chatting with a pair of you today because you are involved in a particular ministry that serves our community. So would you like to tell us a bit about that?
Okay, so we're both involved with Winter Warmers, Winter Warmer Hampers, and have been for, it's about 10 years we tried to work out. And it came out of doing a study of Rick Warren's called 40 Days of Community. And so we've been part of that, yes, and the team has remained really stable. We might have added one or two in along the way, but we've also lost our dear Anita, of course, earlier this year, which was a big loss to our team. She did so much work, and, of course, we all loved her so dearly. So, yes, we have, you know, the team of people, and we stretch really from Aspendale down to Seaford, and we serve. Christina will tell you a little bit more.
This year the packing was a little bit trickier because, of course, having COVID, we had to take a lot of care. So we sort of did it like a bit of a roster. We only came in one or two at a time and did a few things in the church. And then the bags all ended up over at Lynn's daughter's, Lynn and her daughter's Cairo place. Because Lynn's a homeopath or naturopath, whatever you want to call it. And she has rooms there and has a garage that she could store the stuff in. So she stored the bags there, and we arranged for people to come from the school and pick up. And what the school didn't pick up, we delivered. So Dale and I were busy delivering hampers, but we also had to keep in mind of safety. So we packed the envelopes, and they sat around for 2 weeks waiting just in case we, you know, like it was connected with any COVID. So we did take a lot of precautions. Everybody at every step took precautions just to make sure it was, that everything was safe.
And I guess what we didn't mention was that the hampers are made up and they go delivered through the schools to any families that the school deems as being vulnerable or needy. And we packed them with blankets and knitted goods and socks and hats and scarves and vouchers for food. So, you know, every family gets really what they need.
So, and it's all anonymous. That's the important bit, isn't it, Dale? That the schools know who they're going to, but we actually don't. So, you know, it's that anonymity part that's probably good, but maybe it doesn't show our ministry, I suppose. But I feel like God working in their lives. We give them, we pray over it. It's all, at the end, we pray over them and make sure that when they go, they're prayed for. So hopefully they'll do their trick.
So the next question is, why do you think that being involved in winter warmers is an important part of your faith? Is it an important part of your faith?
Yes, I think it's what came to mind for me through when with that question was quite a few Bible passages, I guess, which made me think about, you know, is this a part of the faith and how is that, you know, a part of my faith? Well, it's very much about, I was thinking about James chapter 2, 14 to 17, about faith and works. So, you know, we have this faith in our God and Jesus and Holy Spirit. We need, our works need to go in hand with our faith, because faith without works doesn't work. So the Holy Spirit should be showing us from the inside what we need to do. And it, in this instance, it's guided this team of people over these years to actually want to act out their faith and serve others and to help those that are less fortunate by providing these hampers. And, you know, then I thought of John 13, 34 to 35, a new commandment I give to you, to love one another. How do we show our love? This is an expression of God's love to these people. And there was also 2 Corinthians 9, God loves a person who gives cheerfully. Well, I think within that team of people, there is so, and with so many people in the community that give to this project by knitting, by giving money or by helping us out, there is so much that's going into this, so many people's works and cheerfully helping to put in this expression to others that God actually loves them and cares for them. It doesn't matter who they are. But, yes, yeah, so I think it acts out our faith by showing those things to the families that get these hampers. And we also, oh, no, wrong question. I've looked ahead.
Well, I was, you've got something. I think I should say that it's amazing, really, because with prayer, we always get exactly what we need. Because last year we were always wondering, geez, we've had so much come in this year. You know, it's just amazing. And then this year, of course, we've been locked down with COVID. If we were relying on the stuff that we could have got this year, we'd have been in trouble. Because seriously, we haven't been able to go shopping. So we couldn't get the stuff that we'd needed. And indeed, our COGO, which is the Knit One, Give One, who they are just amazing too for us, because we order stuff and we get it. But we couldn't even get it because they couldn't get into their stock. So they were locked out of their warehouse due to COVID. So we were lucky, but actually it wasn't luck because it was God's luck. The prayer was answered. And we had it from last year, a lot of it. And what wasn't provided last year, we were able to get. But it was that we had the money to be able to do it too. And that's the greatest part, is that God provides for us. But it's also the involvement. Like, I think it's just been important in my life because it's connected me with all my church friends anyway. And serving the Lord, and we are connecting with community through Rotary and Council. The Kingston Council have been marvellous, and we are connecting with the community. And I think that's showing that we're a church that does stuff in the community for others. It isn't just about us, it's about the community and other people and helping others. Mm-hmm. So I think that pretty much answers it, doesn't it?
Yes. I think you might have already answered this question, at least in part.
Yeah. Oh, not like, fully. No. Yes. No, not no, fully. We've got more. We've got more.
The question was, how have you seen God at work in the community through this ministry?
Yeah, so part of what Christina said, definitely. But I think making connections with the primary schools in our area has been wonderful. And I think we saw when Christina and I took over doing Anita's role this year, which was very much the connection with the schools and getting the lists out and everything to them, how devastated they all were that Anita was no longer with us, because she'd built this relationship with them, which is very important connection from the church to the schools and then the schools to the family. So it's Christina and I both being teachers, it was very handy that we, you know, knew how to make those connections too. I guess it was just the way God meant it to be, I believe, that we stepped into that role and had lovely discussions with some of those people. So, and they've come to some of our church services that I know Sue has invited them to along the way. So it's all, to me, drip feeding, and it's all showing, you know, God's love to all these people. Rotary as well, they can see what the good works are and that they come from a faith. They're not just because we want to do good stuff. It's because of we're being obedient to God to do this, and it's in our hearts, on our hearts to do this. So I do think we've created a lot of these relationships and, yeah, opportunities for God's love to be seen and felt by these people.
Mm-hmm. I think it's a lot about connections and hearing about our parish doing the stuff. But look at this. This is just an example. This is a beautiful thank you that was received by our church. And I don't know whether you can see, but that's handmade with lovely butterflies, all shiny. And then it's a little note. And this is just an example. So if we are showing God's love, this is the example. Dear St. Chad's and St. Aidan's, what a delightful surprise to, hold on, receive. Sorry, I can't read without my glasses properly. Receive the winter warmers. Thank you, and for the food support. We also, we are a family of six, and I have no words to tell you how appreciated you all are. Thank you again from our hearts. My grandchildren adore their hats and scarves. The four-year-old wore his to bed. Thank you all. And that's just an example. We know that we're working because for God, because this is God's work. He tells the schools who to give these to. And they need them so much. We've had so many over the years. We've had a number of thank yous, although I can't say we've had one as beautiful as this. This is just amazing. But the letters we've had, not huge amounts, but we know that they're going to people who need them. We don't need this stuff. They need them. This is to people who really are in need. And that's why we're connecting through schools to do this. God, this is how it was all set up. Our wonderful people like Anthea and Lynn and Miriam and Elizabeth and have I got them all? No, there's even more, isn't there? Hillary is involved. There's other people who help. But there's sort of like a staunch group that sort of go, and Bev, oh, I forgot to add Bev, but Bev does too. And there's a lot of people who help with this throughout the year. And, yeah, and I think we're showing God's love in the parish into the community, which is what we're there for.
Do you want to add anything else, Dale? No?
Probably not. I think we've probably said a fair bit.
All right.
I think we have. Yeah.
This is a surprise question.
Oh, yes, I love surprises.
Is there any way that we can be supporting you, especially as we're kind of restricted at the moment in our homes?
Knit hats. I've been knitting. I'd have to run down the other end of my house, but I've been knitting hats and scarves. And that's one thing I did do. And if you need wool, you can always say something. My sister gave me the hugest two bags of wool. I mean, we're talking those coloured shaped ones. And they're like full of wool. I've got wool. I've got the neighbour next door knitting some squares for the blankets. And that's another way. You can just knit those. You know, they're about 8 inches by 8 inches squares. If you do 20 of them, I can crochet them together and make a rug for the winter warmers. We give out at least one blanket and one knee rug to families. And we had 126 families. So we do 126 of those a year. So if you want to help, you could be knitting squares. You don't have to put them together, but keep them all the same size, at least 20 reasonably sized ones. Send them to the church and they'll send them to me and then I'll put them together. Or knit hats and scarves or buy socks. I don't know. What else, Dale, do you think they could do?
Well, they can always give donations if they want to, which...
Yes.
No, not that anyone can get into the church, but there are envelopes. They're probably... got some up at St. Chad's, I would imagine, because you can even get a tax deduction through the diocese too, if they want to. They can make donations. If you can't knit or you don't want to knit, then money is always useful to go into our account that we can buy all these goods with when it comes round. So, and prayer would be the other thing. To keep praying for these families that are struggling, and there's a lot of people struggling, as we know, at the moment, but... prayed for the schools from Seaford to Aspendale, and finding the families that need the help, knowing that God's love can touch them in some way through this project.
And if you can't work out a way to put the money in, there's always going through the Anglican diocese website, the benevolent fund, but you have to earmark it for winter warmer hampers, a bit like you have to for Pantry 5000. So if you've been giving online to Pantry 5000, maybe you can do the same to winter warmers. We always need the money because we go through a fair bit each year. I think possibly about, I think we've gone about $8,000, would you think, this year, Anita? Sorry, Dale. Oh, gosh. Anita and Anita. I often call Dale Anita.
That would be normal around about 8,000. Yeah. And, of course, we've done no fundraising at all this year. Luckily for us, Anthea and Bev have worked on grants. We've been given another grant from Kingston Council for next year. So, again, it's just God's timing that, all of a sudden we've had quite a few grants over the last couple of years, which is carrying us through, really, when we can't fundraise. So, that's been great too.
Slight question, and it's only because I'm new and I haven't been around winter warmers for very long, but what does that money go to? Does it go to knitting materials or something else?
No.
So the money mostly goes, a lot of the money goes on the food vouchers that we give to the family. So if there's, three in the family, they get a certain number of vouchers, I get one voucher. So if there's five in the family, they'll get two or three vouchers.
No, every family gets two vouchers at this point, but we add extras for, if they've got about six in the family, they probably get three or four vouchers. But so every family, so now think of this, we did 126 and we gave at least $50 to each of those families. But of course we gave more than 50 to some. So you can understand, we go through a lot, but we consider this, well, we considered it 2 years ago, $25 doesn't do much. $50 doesn't do a lot either, but at least it's better than $25. So every family gets at least $50 and we give extra. Whatever we can, it goes. And believe me, we spend a lot on vouchers. So most of it's vouchers. The rest, I think pretty much most of it's donated. isn't it, Dale? I think socks.
Oh no, I think all the blankets that Lynn buys, have to be bought, and we've got she's got a good deal with this guy who's been supplying us for years. He actually gave blankets, and we also got some dressing gowns, some terry toweling dressing gowns and stuff like that. That's certainly, and then there are times where we do have to buy, like this year we had to buy hats and scarves, men's hats and scarves, and boys, and we also buy the socks as well. But then a lot of the people in winter warmers donate money. They just buy things and they don't want the money back. So it sort of pans out, you know. But yeah.
And I should have mentioned Robin there, shouldn't I? Robin Wheatley, because Robin Wheatley's part of our group too, and she usually looks after the socks end. She knows who to go to for the socks.
That's awesome. All right. Well, it sounds like there's a lot on the go there, and we can help out by either donating money, knitting amazing things, maybe from the sound of it, particularly men's hats and scarves.
Definitely. Dark colours. This is the trouble. People hate doing dark colours, but I've been doing dark colours. And I can't see half the time, so dark colours is good.
Yeah, and then we need to smother the whole ministry in prayer for you.
Yes.
Oh, absolutely. That would be lovely. We need a lot of prayer, trust me.
All right, Dale. Thank you very much, ladies, for spending some time with me and telling us a little bit about your ministry. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Okay.
Bye, everyone.
Well, the gospel message, Jesus died, he rose again, we know God's forgiveness, and he has ascended to heaven and is at the right hand of the Father. So let's sing about what Christ has done for us with a grateful heart.
Again, So today it is my pleasure to read the Bible with you, to share some reflections and to have a bit of a pray. So I'm going to pray, I'm going to read the Bible, and then I'm going to share my thoughts with you. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the chance we have today to come together and to open your word. Father God, I pray that you settle us into a time of learning, that we can set aside all the stress and the anxieties that we've faced this week. We lay them at your feet for you to deal with. Father God, I pray that as we come together, we can learn from your word, that we can encourage one another, and that we walk away changed, or at least challenged, by your spirit. Amen. All right, so it's my pleasure today to read James chapter 2, 14 to 26. So here we go. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or a sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply the food. And one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs. What good is that? So faith by itself has no works, is dead. But some will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and by my works I will show you my faith. If you believe that God is one, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Do you want to be shown, you senseless person, that faith apart from work is barren? Was not our ancestor Abraham justified by works when he offered his son Isaac to the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was brought to completion by the works. Thus the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed in God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. Likewise, was not Rahab the prostitute also justified by works when she welcomed the messengers and sent them out by another road? For just as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is also dead. It's a bit of a call to action, is James 2. In fact, I find that all of James is a call to action and a call to change of behavior. So let's kind of jump into it. So I'm not sure if you've ever noticed this kind of strange period of time that I'm going to talk about, but it's kind of that time that happens after Christmas and Boxing Day, but before the new year starts. Kind of all the family stuff, the Christmas tradition stuff is done, but the new year hasn't started yet. It's kind of this weird in between times, kind of, I guess, a little bit like now. And I've noticed that within my family and within my friendship circles, we clean out the old and get ready for the new. We reflect a little bit more on the things that were in the previous year as we get ready for the new year. And we often make ourselves these promises. We make promises about how work's going to go, how we're going to change, how we re-engage with people. We might have conversations and make promises about relationships that we're in, about how we might change them or grow them. We might have a conversation about our attitudes towards exercise or work or study. We promise to change something. However, I also find that while we talk a good talk in that in-between week or so, that, and then we might enact it for a little while, we might do the walks, we might stand up for ourselves a bit more in different relationships or soften ourselves in different relationships as well, like being more receptive to other people's views or reading the newspaper. But I've also noticed that by the time February comes, or even March, if we're having a really good crack at changing our behaviour, that it kind of peters off, it kind of fades away as the reality of work, the reality of being in various relationships kind of hits home. And it kind of peters off a little bit. And I think that's kind of what James is kind of getting at. You can't just say you're going to believe in God and not have that change. Now, I'm not sure whether you've noted, whether you noticed as we were reading the passage that there's a faith is a key aspect of today's reading. And I think it's worth kind of defining faith a little bit. So the Cambridge Dictionary defines faith as having a trust or confidence in a higher power or person. Not a higher person, but like having faith in people or a higher power. And I think that our faith is a little bit more than that. But we'll get into that. But I also think that that's such a simple version of faith. I also think that before we go too much further, we should also define what we believe in, because faith at its simplest is a belief in something greater than us. So as Christians, I think it's clear that we should, or I'm going to state that it's clear, that we believe in the Creator God. We believe that God created the world. However he did that, he created the world for us to live in, and that we as a humanity turned our back away from him and are living in a broken world. And then God, in his love and desire for us to be in right relationship with him, sent his son down to earth to bring us back into relationship with God through his life, death, and resurrection. Okay? And that when he went back to God, when Jesus went back to God, he left or sent the Holy Spirit to us to encourage us to grow, to encourage us to be the people God wants us to be, so that we can feel his love and see him at work in the world. Okay? And we nurture our faith through reading the Bible, through prayer, through engaging in conversation with one another, as we seek to support and grow one another's faith. Okay? Now, I personally don't know where you are in your walk with God at the moment. You might not even have a relationship with God yet, and that's okay. Ask the questions. It's a good thing to do. You might be feeling a bit distant from God at the moment. I know a lot of people are doing it tough because of COVID. They're not seeing their friends. We're not coming together to worship. And so it's really easy to be angry at God at the moment. And it's really easy to feel distant from him. But you need to remember too that God is a great God, and he weeps with us and he loves us, and that he can take your anger and your grief and your hurt. So don't be afraid to get angry at God. He can handle it. Or you might be on the other side of that. You might be completely happy. You can see God at work in your world. You might be spending heaps of time in the Bible. You might be spending lots of time praying because you're not able to get out and do the things with the normal people that you might. And all of those things are natural in your faith walk, and totally normal. Reach out to us at Longbeach. We'd love to hear from you and to have a chat if you need to, so do that. But I do think that faith presents itself differently to different people. I have some friends that are very logical thinkers, and they've kind of defined their relationship with God in peaks and valleys, like a linear kind of chart. They're always growing closer to God, but there are times when they feel really close, and then times when they don't, and then times when they do, and times when they don't, and it kind of goes like that. It's a very angular way of seeing their relationship with God. I've got other friends who are hugely creative, very visual thinkers, and they see their life or their walk with God as a journey. And they see God with them through the hills and the valleys of life. When it's tough and it's dark and they're in the woods and it's horrible, they see God. They know that God's with them. And they also see God when everything's in comfort and ease and their journey is on horseback or whatever. They see it as a much more of a journey together, like you see Lord of the Rings or something like that. It's very, we're together in this, we're growing together. I personally kind of see my faith as spirals or loops with God that have changed color over time. The spiral is wide and slow when I'm not in right relationship with God, in that I've let my Bible readings falter a little bit, or I'm not honestly praying to God, or I'm just kind of like praying in lip service. So it's a very wide then, but at the times when I'm close to God, the circle gets smaller. and I'm reading the Bible well and I'm praying well and I can see God really clearly at work. It's like this really close circle. It's a very small circle that's just kind of going around, and then it gets bigger and it gets smaller and it gets bigger and it gets smaller. And I think that no matter how you see your journey with God going, no, whether it's in lines or whether it's a journey or whether it's in circles, it doesn't really matter, because the point is that however we're doing it, we're growing and we're changing into who God's called us to be, right? So having an understanding of what faith looks like for you and what we believe in and striving for that right relationship to God, with God, is important for today's passage. Because without that faith, we might not do the things that James and God are calling us to do in this space. There is this movie, and it's a Nicolas Cage movie, and it's called National Treasure. I don't know if you've seen it, so I'm going to try and not give the ending away, but it's this story of Nicolas Cage's character, who I've forgotten his name. He and his little gaggle of friends go off to find this treasure, and they've got to beat the bad guys to it. It's a good, honest, well, not honest. It's honestly a good family movie. Anyways, what's that got to do with faith, you ask? Well, we're getting to that. To get to one of the clues to get to the treasure, Nicolas Cage and his gaggle of friends find these glasses. And these glasses have different lenses on them. And as you move the lenses in different combinations, you can see different aspects of the clue in different detail. So I think that's kind of a good way to think about this passage, is that our faith changes how we see the details of the world, kind of like how that those glasses help Nicolas Cage see the different details of the clue. Because when we look at the world through the lenses of God's love, we see the world differently. We see the things in it that break God's heart. We notice the injustice and we get frustrated by it, and we get passionate. We should be getting passionate for it. But our faith helps us to see those injustices differently. It helps us, these lenses, seeing the world through the lens of God's love, helps us to see him at work more. So I'm doing this because the glasses have different lenses that go like this. I'll stop. So this is kind of where today's passage really comes into its own, I think, because James is compelling the followers of Jesus into action. The church was saying that they understood God's love for them and that they were Christian, but they weren't acting out or letting that faith change them to the point where they were trying to change the world to what God wanted it to be. They weren't reaching out to the sick and the needy. They weren't caring for the vulnerable in their society anymore. And I think that frustrated James, and that's how come he's telling them, come on, guys, you've got to get your act together. You know, he brings in the instance of Abraham and Isaac. Like, Abraham so loved God that and had such great faith in God that he was getting to the point where he would sacrifice his only child. Like, that's huge. We know that in the end, Abraham didn't, so it's okay. But Abraham's faith prompted him into action. Rahab's faith in how she dealt with sending the messengers on, was her act of faith. She had a faith in God. She had a faith that God would look after her during that war, and it gave her the courage to change, to send those messengers away. Like, her faith prompted her actions. So I think it's also important to note here too that your works, the things that you do, don't save you. It's your faith that saves you. It's your faith that prompts your change in action. It's handy to know that going on. And I think it's also important to note that kind of when you think about your own story, yes, this Holy Spirit is in you and it's moving and you have a deep relationship with God through that, but it was probably through the actions of somebody around you that you saw God's love enacted. So for me, it probably started with my parents. We went to church, they listened to the Bible, and then we got home and they acted with dignity and integrity. It might have been somebody at work, and for you who dealt with the world in a way that had dignity and all of that kind of stuff. When they said they'd get work done, it would be done. They wouldn't let things slide. They wouldn't kind of debase their morals for the good of the company. They would stand by their word. They would do what they said they would do. It might have been that a youth leader took the time to get to know you and to understand you. And then you're like, but why? Why are you doing these things? And they go, well, let me tell you about Jesus. And it's how they acted, how they treated the people around them that drew you into a deeper relationship with God, or started your relationship with God. And it would have been those people as well that nurtured that a little bit. They invited the Holy Spirit in. They were open for conversation. They were open to have a cup of tea and a chat about matters of faith until you are able to stand on your own faith, till you accepted it. They would have taught you how to read the Bible and how to pray and to welcome you into the Christian family, whatever that might have looked like for you. But how they acted showed you how God loved. And it should be a demonstration of how people's love of God changes the way that we engage with one another. And I think probably the most important thing we can draw from this passage is that our faith shouldn't be passive. It's not just saying that we believe in God, it's doing God's work in the world. Now, how you do that is going to be completely unique to yourself. I know for myself that I could never do what the Matt's Place team does. I wouldn't even begin to know how to organize all the food, how to cook it, and serve it to so many people. I couldn't even begin to sort out the logistics or to be a part of that process for Pantry 5000. Just couldn't. Same with the op shop. No idea where I'd start if I was going to step into that space, into that ministry. I can kind of knit. So I'm knitting some scarves for winter warmers. Hopefully they'll be okay. We'll see. YouTube's a good thing. So I can do that. I can help people grow in their faith. So I can reach out to the world to show them God's love through those sorts of things. I can knit. I can do that. Christmas presents this year for me, gonna be tricky because I have a big family and there's lots of shipping. So there's a good chance that instead of actually getting my siblings a gift, I will get them toilets in Africa or something from the Tea Gift Catalogue, which is a card but actually gives to the community, who gives to our brothers and sisters in Africa and places where they don't have toilets or educational things. Or there are just so many different ways that we can contribute to helping the lives of others be better. I can add things to my Woolworths order at the moment to fill a Christmas box through Samaritan's Purse. There are things that we can be doing that will better the lives of the people around us, even if we can't touch them or see them. So whether it's time or money or materials, we can and we should be using the gifts God's given us through our faith to make the world a better place. What breaks our hearts for God will be different for each of us as well. So you might donate more money to missionaries because the fact that people don't know who Jesus is just shatters your heart. It might be that young people not having the things that they need for an education or to eat might bring you to tears. So you might sponsor a child through compassion or world vision. Maybe it's knowing that people in our own backyard are doing it tough and that we finding a way that we can help at Pantry or the op shop or Pantry or Winter Warmers at the moment before, during and after COVID, like, there are ways that we can use our gifts and our skills and our talents in some way to support our community. As we finish, I guess I really just want to encourage you to not to let your faith just be something you talk about or to do on a Sunday. Find your way to show God's love to the world. Find the thing that breaks your heart that you can become passionate about, so that you can change the world a little bit. You can show it God's love and that you can draw nearer to God, or do good for God without any strings attached. Because it's your faith. It's because you love God and he loves you. So I guess that's kind of it for me about this. So I'm going to pray. And what's going to come next is going to be a couple more videos of ways that we can get involved with things. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the chance that we have to show the world your love. Father God, I pray this week as we think about the ways that we can engage with the world that you point us in the right direction. Father God, help us to think about our gifts and things that we can do to show the world your love. Help us to be creative in this time of COVID. And find practical ways that we can enact your love, even if we can't physically get close to people. Father God, we thank you for your spirit and the fact that we do have brothers and sisters in Christ who are seeking to better the world that we live in. Amen. All right. Thanks, guys.
3, 2, 1. At the count of 3, when children open the shoe boxes, they're so excited.
Those faces just transform.
Yeah, these kids behind me are so excited because they've just received their boxes.
The mouth is wide open, the voice is raised, smiles are all over. That box brings joy.
We're right now in Phnom Penh in Cambodia. I mean, it's just been incredible. Kids are so excited, giving them a gift, do it in Jesus' name, and that's what this is all about.
Jesus loves you.
It's a gospel opportunity. It's the chance for the children to change the entire life.
That's what I love about Operation Christmas Child. It knows no borders, it knows no boundaries. It's all about sharing the name of Jesus Christ.
Churches are doing big things with Operation Christmas Child.
Everybody out there who packs shoeboxes, they are spreading God's love.
It's families, it's churches, it's hundreds of thousands of volunteers that help make Operation Christmas Child so successful. We couldn't do it without them.
With this box, they do get the gospel story. They do hear about Jesus.
It has maximum impact in the worldwide kingdom of Christ. I mean, what better thing could you do than be involved and fill shoeboxes?
Some of them go by train, some go by camels, some go by ships. These boxes go all over the world, and that is only the beginning.
After receiving the shoe boxes, the children will be invited to go through the Greatest Journey, which is a 12-lesson discipleship program where they learn about the greatest gift, which is Jesus Christ.
After a child completes the Greatest Journey, they graduate and receive a Bible in their own language.
Nag-istorya ado pa hindi nga kanta mo may kampaid ang kankan dadita sa angum imbasa mo basi hindi mo ni papa ni lola ni lolo ni papa mamat kat mamati daken ni Apo Diyos.
When the light of the gospel is turned on, that changes everything.
Churches are being planted.
Lives are being changed. Communities are being transformed.
The word of God is spreading. The gospel is advancing.
It is impacting children. It is impacting families. It is impacting the world greatly.
Thank you for praying. Thank you for giving. I would like to ask you to consider packing shoeboxes year-round. God will bless, and God will use your gift to touch the life of a child and to be able to do it in Jesus' name. So thank you. Thank you for being a part of it. God bless each and every one of you.
Okay, so let's pray together. So we'll pray for the world, we'll pray for our community, and yeah, let's get to it. Hey, so make yourself comfortable, make yourself ready, do whatever it is you do when you pray, and let's do this. Hey, Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the gift of your Son Jesus. We thank you so much for your overwhelming love for humanity and your creation. Father God, we just thank you so much for the weather this week. We thank you so much that it was beautiful, spring, sunshiny days. Father God, we thank you so much that we have technology to talk to each other with, whether it's on the phone or on an online platform. Father God, we just thank you so much for that way of communicating with each other. Father God, we just lift up to you the world. Father God, we lift up to you the US, Russia, India, Colombia, and Brazil, Lord. Their COVID numbers are really high at the moment. So, Father God, we pray that your hand is over those nations, that they are doing their best as a whole countries, I guess, to limit the spread, to flatten their curves, and to... give strength and comfort to the families and the people that are serving in those communities, all the doctors and nurses and healthcare workers. Give them resources and strength that they never knew they had. Father God, we do lift up to Australia and our COVID situation. Father God, we don't have quite the numbers as some of the other places around the world, but it's been a long time for us Victorians as we have... faced isolation and quarantine and lockdowns and the separation of our friends and family. Father God, we just lift up to you all those in our community that have got the COVID, the 230-ish people. Father God, we pray for your healing hand to be over them. May they recover swiftly from COVID and may they recover well as well. Father God, we thank you so much that the numbers have come down for new cases. We thank you that they're down into single digits, and we just pray that the trend continues that way. Father God, we lift up to you our nurses and our doctors and our healthcare system, not just in Victoria but around the country. We thank you so much for the care and the ongoing commitment the people in that work in those spaces have for their patients. Father God, we just again pray for strength and ongoing energy for them as they deal with working in a high stress environment at the moment. Father God, we do lift up to you our nation's leaders, and in particular Dan Andrews and Brett Sutton. Father God, they've got a tough gig at the best of times, and at the moment they're doing their best to look after a majority of people. So Father God, I pray that you open their eyes to the best way forward, that they continue to put the needs of the people before, the pressure to do or not to do things. May they reflect well on the information that they're given and proceed accordingly. Father God, we thank you so much for our parish. We thank you for Longbeach, Anglican, and for the leadership teams of the various ministries. We thank you so much for the way that our community is committed to helping the people around them. Father God, I pray that you lay on our hearts the things that break yours, that we find ways as individuals and as a community to serve you, to bring your kingdom here. Father God, we just pray that your Holy Spirit continues to grow our faith, that we continue to draw near to you. Father God, I lift up to you the following people from the prayer list. Father God, we lift up to you today Alan F, Carol, Caroline, Chris and family, Clary, Dan, Dirk, Elizabeth, Caden and Pat, Fiona, Gary, Gladys, Isaac, Jackie and Raymond, Jackie, Karen, Kevin, Laura, Lawrence, Lillian family, Linda, Liz and Gabriel, Lorraine, Margaret, Mavis, Michael C, Nigel and Chris, Nola, Pat John, Pat and Joe, Rachel, Ryan, Shireen, Sterling, Sue, Thomas, Wayne and Elaine. Father God, you know better than we do the things that are going on in their lives. So we pray for healing, strength and comfort in whatever space they need or whatever quantities they need. May they feel your presence, healing and guiding them forward. And Father God, we do lift up to you all the people in our community that are struggling at the minute with isolation and loneliness and kind of just the ongoing pressure of being in COVID. Lift our spirits this week, Lord. Help us to see you in the little things and the big things, and draw us nearer to you. Amen.
Hi,
we're the Wiggles.
And we heard it's your birthday, and we'd like to sing you a very happy birthday.
Happy birthday to
Jarvison, Ashgood, Caden, Kate, and Dorothy.
Happy birthday to
Jarvison, Ashgood, Caden, Kate, and Dorothy.
Happy birthday, happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Yeah.
lesson. Manna rained down from heaven. This isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and the children, and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family,
and your children,
and their children,
and their children.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family,
and your children,
and their children,
and their children.
May his favor be upon you.